What do I actually want to provide to my customers? Cost engineering is under pressure to reduce cost. One of our utmost important jobs is actually to connect people. They try to reduce workforce and all other capabilities. They were able to reduce and cut the cost by 80%. Now they need to actually find the next 20%. Increasing automation in purchasing means I am actually able to create tenders faster. IT departments are always lacking resources. It will be a substitution of the workforce. I believe that an AI can actually take this over.
Welcome to a new podcast episode of the Cinera podcast, the Connected Engineering podcast. Today we have a very special guest, namely Ralf Altpeter from Fakton. And today we'll talk about the interesting topic of cost engineering. Ralf, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, yourself. And thank you very much for having us to your podcast.
Yeah, sure. Before we delve into the nitty-gritty of cost engineering, can you give the audience maybe a quick overview, like who is Ralf in the first place, what are you doing, and actually what is Fakton doing in the first place?
Right, yeah, thank you very much. Let's do that. So my name is Ralf. I'm the general manager of Fakton. The company is focused on cost management, cost engineering software. So we provide solutions for our customers to get a grip on product cost throughout the life cycle, starting from a quotation through the controlling during the development process, up until to create transparency for negotiations in the supply chain. So this is our focus. Myself, I worked for about 20 years in consultancy. Most time of it in automotive and in cost engineering. My background, mechanical engineering. So I'm really coming from the perspective of the user in this area. And that's why I'm also really looking forward to discussing all the options we see in our collaboration with Cinera. Mm-hmm. As I think automation is one of the real driving topics that we currently see in the industry.
Yeah, very interesting. We'll talk about automation in a second. I think what would be interesting to understand is cost engineering. Like, what is the definition for cost engineering and what does it include?
Cost engineering is, if you really drill it down or bring it down to the fundamentals, is basically creating transparency. It's getting an understanding of how products are manufactured and why they are manufactured in a way driven by design, by locations and other assumptions that underlie the specification. So that you really understand where do I have my cost drivers and how can I influence the cost drivers in the way that in the end, you can actually bring down the product cost while not harming the overall value of the product. Because it's not just about the focus in the end of on the product cost themselves. It's also on what do I actually want to provide to my customers. So to create a value through functionality. And this is basically the job that we have as cost engineers to create the balance between cost and value.
Yeah, interesting. Before this whole automation thing came along, how does the status quo maybe even in other companies look like nowadays? So is it done manually? And where do you see, like, in terms of information leakage, the big problems happening in the industry, like if you don't use automation?
Right. So also traditionally, cost engineering, and this is the beauty of the job, it's not just about numbers and processes and stuff like this. It's pretty much a cross-functional endeavor. That we take and that we see. So we are, beside of creating transparency, one of our utmost important jobs is actually to connect people, to connect the designer with the manufacturing, to connect the purchaser with controlling, and to connect all those guys together that they have like, hey, this is where we're at, this is where we stand, and this is where we, and how we can actually together create the value to the customer, or optimize our cost. What we see currently is that this is dramatically shifting, because the sole focus on mechanical products and the functionality provided by mechanical products is more and more shifting to the software. So the main emphasis, this is really shifting towards software. And what you can see is that basically while companies build up their software capabilities, they try to reduce workforce and all other capabilities. Is it mechanical engineering? Is it cost engineering? Is it finance, HR, all those things? So, and how to do this without suffering and without losing actually control over processes that have been established and proven to be actually well established and well functioning. So automation is automatically becoming an increasing need, because what parts of the process they are and what parts of activities I can automate, the better I can actually really convert and do that shift to the new software defined vehicle, software defined products, connectivity. I mean, it's not only automotive, no? It's other industries as well.
Yeah, you talked about the connectivity aspect. So basically connecting different departments to actually speak the same language, or at least give them an overview about cost or other important KPIs in the product development process. Where do you see is like the biggest problem at the moment? Like, let's say, before we jump to this Genera topic and then also automation, where do you see the huge problems are happening? I think you kind of mentioned it a little bit, but maybe delving a little bit deeper into it to also understand or make the audience understand where the big problems lie at the moment.
So what I can see is, or there are two major effects that I see. So it's like the 80-20 rule, right? So you start with cost engineering, you're getting really professional with it, right? And I think what a lot of companies already matured is that they created a very good cost basis for themselves, right? And those they were able to reduce and cut the cost by 80%. Now they need to actually find the next 20%. And as we know, the 80% take 20% effort, the next 20% will take 80% of the effort. So you really have to put in a lot of work, a lot of creativity, ideas, and actually it's becoming more disruptive at that point in time. So this is actually the opposite of what we discussed before. So am I really actually able to reduce my workforce, and what will happen? And the other thing is that other functionalities, and we can see this in purchasing especially, like that we see increasing automation in purchasing means I am actually able to create tenders faster and to actually negotiate faster, etc. But if you have a system where cost engineering provides benchmark pricing for any negotiation or deal taking, you actually don't have enough workforce and you're not fast enough to create those values. And this is like, okay, how do you solve it? So how can you actually maintain a well-honed process that proved to be very good and that is established and that is beneficial for the companies? And not derailing it, not forgetting about it. So this is like the two fundamentals where I see cost engineering is a little bit under pressure also to create new ideas and a philosophy where you really need to think about making things in a different way.
Yeah. When we talk about different solutions in industry, I mean, you're the expert, Ralf, talk about high code, low code software, all these kind of things. Like what are the existing solutions out there in the industry? And then maybe shifting to the topic of low code and what it actually, how it benefits engineers or people like you.
Yeah. The solutions out in the market and solutions that we provide are still very much focused on the expert users, right? So you have a lot of options, a lot of functionality, a lot of variations that you can actually bring into the costing or the costing schemes. There are tools that are more focused on creating transparency, and then there are tools like us that are more focused on already integrating them into the IT architecture, with interfaces to ERP systems, PLM systems, etc. And this is like the current state of the art that I see. And then you have tools that you use for, or that are more honed to special functionalities, like the engineering, where you try to automate the CAD to cost module, so we call that. So you have a CAD design, you want to have transparency, and then you click on a button and you get a cost breakdown. And then you change the design, you click on the button, and then you can already see, okay, where's the difference? Did I actually optimize the cost, or is it becoming more expensive, right? But these are in itself solutions that are defined for a special purpose. So you ask about low code, and this is where I think in general the benefit comes into play with a low code platform, because we've discussed cost engineering is under pressure to reduce cost. Mm-hmm. So are IT departments, right? So IT departments are always lacking resources and are always actually lacking personnel to come up with interfaces and stuff like this. So to have a low code platform where I actually can more or less plug and play different systems, state of the art systems, state of the art CAD systems, state of the art PLM connectors, state of the art costing tools, etc., all together. Carbon footprint is one of those topics as well. So if you can plug this together, you can actually start building a system over time that benefits the purposes of automation and improving, that benefits the purpose of not capturing knowledge, yeah, and that is not lacking of resources, and you don't have to wait like a year or 18 months until somebody says, okay, I'm actually now able to create the interface.
I see. So how do you actually measure the ROI or the impact of such a solution in your organization, such as Factor?
Also we would and could measure it actually by the use of the system. So our general output is a costing. Either it's an initial costing, it's an estimation, mm-hmm. it's an estimation of a product change, a supplier change, and whatnot. So we create basically costings, yeah, or cost breakdowns. And you can actually pretty simply just count the amount of cost breakdowns we create. And my goal is, or our goal is, to actually increase the amount of costings with creating solutions where you can use outputs from other systems, create or put these into a cost breakdown, and then you actually already get a final result without a cost engineering touching it. Yeah. So this is basically how we would or could measure it.
Yeah. One thing I forgot, Ralf, maybe taking one step back, is the aspect of transparency that you mentioned, right? So basically cross-functional development and maybe the development of low-code solutions. How important do you think is that the solution that you're actually using is a gray box, so not actually a black box, just using different blocks on defining the cost engineering process, but actually mm-hmm. also having non-experts understand what they actually see on screen? How important do you think that is?
What is from or of the utmost importance is if you create transparency and if you do it in the early stage, and then you have like design changes and you take certain decisions, and there a lot of decisions are always taken in throughout a product lifecycle, no? From the engineer to the top management level, when you're in a certain stage, you always had like these, okay, this was the cost that we actually initially have. Now we are at this stage and we implemented those changes, and this was reducing material cost, this increased manufacturing cost, and so on and so forth. So you always need to have not only the transparency at this point of time, but you also need to have like the transparency throughout all the quality gates and stages you actually have in a product development process. Yeah. That being said, the what I think is super important when for example you decide for a certain technology, it needs to be transparent to everybody why you actually decided for this, right? And this can't be an algorithm taking the decision and you just like believe in the algorithm, because as soon as you hit the real life and as soon as you start talking with a supplier, these questions will come up. And then you need to be 100% clear why decisions are taken and why you believe that this is actually the correct price. Mm-hmm. If you have like any, from the beginning to that point, if you have like any holes in your arguments, then you lose credibility. And thus, it really has an impact on your negotiation.
Yeah.
And if you're losing credibility in that position, you're not able to actually negotiate a good price. So it really has an impact on the baseline in the end of how much spend you have.
Absolutely. Yeah, that makes sense. Could you maybe talk about one of the use cases or maybe success stories that you've worked on at Fakton using this local solution, namely Cinera?
Yeah. Also what we are currently building together with the customer is a demo where we have certain aspects of a product. And it's a sub-assembly that we take and that we are able to analyze through or based on PLM data as well as on CAD data, right? And then based on the information that we can extract out of the systems, we are able to create a bill of material that we can import into Fakton. And based on our costings that we already have and our costing schemes, we can then easily actually get an initial cost breakdown. The beauty of it is that we can do this for well-known commodities, but the experts can always build on top of these for new technologies coming, right? And we can see a lot of customers currently shifting their product portfolio from conventional to e-mobility, yeah? Mm-hmm. Because they need to have like a certain new fields they can operate in. One is going down, the other one is going up. But with this transition, you also have like new technologies coming into play. And thus, to have a system where you can have like your own experts add on new technologies is actually very important, right? And the use case we are currently building is for a commodity to get it up and running, to understand what we are doing, to understand how it works, yeah, to train the people. And if this demo is actually flying, then we can go the next step, right? And then we can actually create an ecosystem that captures knowledge from the experts, and then we can actually build on that.
Yeah, that makes sense. I wonder, Ralf, how replicable you think these tools are. Let's say you build a basic workflow with Cinera, right? And you use it for customer A, you tweak it a little bit. How much of the percentage would you say is it replicable for, let's say, customer B or C, adapting that existing workflow?
Yeah, I think it's actually the workflow you can take in place anywhere, right? Yeah. The thing is, and this is what I see as one of the most powerful arguments, you need to be open. You need to have like a very open system to it, mm-hmm. right? You will always have actually tools that are specialized or focused on certain areas. Yeah? And this is not only on costing, but this is also in engineering and various other tools. We also have like in the CSI galaxy, we have different tools as well that focus on simulation in the automotive, but they are so focused that they are really in the combustion engine. Yeah, and, mm-hmm. and this is their expertise. And then you have other simulation tools that are more into FEM and whatnot solutions. But to have a platform that actually brings this all together, you can really build workflows that are really honed to the specialities of that company. And then you can also put in maybe also own developed tools, captive tools that you use that are, for example, a differentiator to your competition, etc. So I think this is one of the great things of this solution, that you really can focus on your process, yeah? And you have the flexibility of bringing in the tools you need.
Yeah, I like the thing that you said about open systems. I think a couple of weeks ago, you and I discussed if it's actually an Android system lookalike or more like an Apple ecosystem. I think then you said it's more like an Android system from the openness point of view, so you can basically connect everything you want. But then from a usability point of view, it kind of resembles Apple in the sense of like it's very easy to use, very easy to adapt, right? Would you agree to that?
Yeah, and I agree to this because on top of it, you can always build a surface, a UI that is honed to the features that this function uses and needs. Yeah, let's take purchasing. I just need a quick analysis so I can open up the quick estimator, input a few parameters, and then I already get a cost breakdown that fits. This is from a usability perspective. I think there are a lot of options that you can actually take and use that will benefit several functions in this company.
Absolutely. Talking about the automation aspect, I think it would be interesting to understand, do you think the automation is a substitution for a workforce? If no or yes, why?
It will be a substitution of the workforce due to the reasons I have explained in the beginning, right? Because there is a shift and you need to shift budget from the traditional to the new one,
yeah,
and to the new businesses. So this is just a given. The question is, how are we able how can we enable the remaining workforce to actually cope with the business they still have to do? Because my experience is you always reduce workforce, but you are not really reducing the workload. Right. Mm-hmm. So we really have to enable these guys to still cope with the workload at hand.
Yeah, that makes sense. How do you think the future of the cost engineering job actually will change?
I think it will change more to really the expert again. Mm-hmm. There are two things you need to focus on. The real value add with cost engineering comes when you have like value engineering workshops. You bring everybody together, you have a good moderation, preparation, and you will actually generate ideas to bring costs down. And there you can actually see a difference between like the guys they do all with the same scheme, then you will always have the same ideas, and the guys who will put more creativity into it. And then you mm-hmm. can actually see that new ideas come up and you will really see an impact on this. So this will be one of the job descriptions: creativity, bring people together, moderation, workshops, stuff like this, driving these. The other stuff still will be the negotiations. Fact-based negotiations are just part of the purchasing day-to-day, beside of other things like auction and stuff. This will also remain. And this is also value add, because within the negotiation, you actually discuss cost and you just nail it down to the level. Mm-hmm. And these will be two fundamentals that will remain. I believe what will be less in the future is the actual costing, because the actual costing will come based on the expert knowledge and the cost models that will be built up once, and then mm-hmm. they are actually aligned within the company and remain optimized and updated, of course, as technology is increasing. But to create a costing, to take a drawing, enter all the numbers, get the cost breakdown, I think this will dramatically be cut out.
Yeah, from Facton's point of view, or maybe Ralph's point of view in this case, how do you think AI will play a significant role in the job of a cost engineer, but in general of cost engineering?
I think AI will play an important role and can play an important role because, as per my understanding, AI is a substitution for a decision, right? When I take the process of a cost engineer, you take a drawing, you look at it, and then you mm-hmm. decide, like, what manufacturing process do I take? And these decisions are based on certain parameters: what material, what are the tolerances, and those other, and there are other criteria. But like, and these fundamental decisions I believe in that an AI can actually take this over, and there are two ways of doing it. Either you do it in a rule based system where you already know, okay, this kind of material like this kind of material like this. I think the benefit of an AI is that you, beside of those rules, it actually always takes maybe two or three decisions. Maybe it has a question mark, but you can play with these and you can actually try to already optimize costs based on these decisions where you have, no, and this is, I think, faster, and you can learn a lot faster. And it also, I think, will take a lot of burden from the cost engineering experts to actually create rule by rule by rule by rule. Because in the end, if you have 1,000 rules, it also becomes maybe a little bit intransparent.
Absolutely. Apart from AI, Ralf, do you think there's any other trends in the field of cost engineering that you see maybe coming in the next 5 to 10 years?
Certainly. What I've said in the beginning with this software part as well, I think this will be a large part as well, because we now have pretty much already a good transparency when it comes to manufacturing and all the pieces. What we see is, on the other hand, that budgets for software, for projects, and also updates and things down the road, that these budgets are actually heavily increasing. But we still lack actually transparency. So there are a few methods at hand, function points, story points, and whatnot, how you can actually estimate those things and how you can do this. And a couple of companies already do this very thoroughly. Others do it more high level. But to get a common understanding, OEM to the supplier, to the sub-supplier, how this actually works, how can we estimate it, how do we get transparency into this? How can we discuss and measure things that we currently have not specified maybe into depth? This will be kind of a new field and a new trend. What I think becomes more and more important, because budgets are increasing and it's becoming the game changer in the future. And coming with the lack of resources, code is resource, at least at the moment still, the less you need, the better it is.
Absolutely. Yeah, we're approaching half an hour, Ralf. Is there anything else we might have missed in terms of cost engineering, the topic, maybe something that you would tell the audience?
At this point, I really have to say I'm really looking forward to our first endeavor that we have with our customers in understanding and finding out how we can actually set up the automation. This is a real game changer for me, because this makes an expert tool and embeds an expert tool into an environment that can be used not only by the expert, but by a lot of different functions as well. And this is actually for me what I see for the really near term, the most fun part actually of the job. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Super exciting. Absolutely. And if people would like to know more, I think we also had an expert panel hosted by Cinero where you also talked about cost engineering. We actually showed a demo, a couple of slides. So I think if people want to delve in depth into cost engineering, they can check this webinar out, as well as the cost engineering white paper. And if they have any more questions, Ralf, I'm also going to link down maybe your LinkedIn profile or your email address down under this podcast, and people can reach out to you in case they have any more questions.
Would appreciate that. Maybe a little spoiler. So we also plan to have a podcast ready in April, May, right? To really also show our next stage of how we deal with sub-assemblies and assemblies, right? Mm-hmm. Really looking forward to this. And other than that, I thank you very much, actually, for hosting the podcast.
Thank you so much for attending the podcast. And I think the episode will be ready soon, so people can check it out. And again, if they have any more questions, if they want to try Cinero, I think there's a 14-day free trial, quite sure, 14-day. And then any more questions regarding cost engineering, maybe to Fakdon, I'm going to link Ralf's profile, LinkedIn profile down in the description as well. So with that, thank you very much, and have a nice day.
Thank you, Yosef. Bye-bye.